So I will present to you the result of my research about how we could create furries with existing biotechnology. So the outline of my topic classic, introduce the subject, give you the idea of how we could make a furry from a human and from an animal. What is a furry?
Make us laugh too much, the screen will check.
So, a good definition could be that a furry is just a creature that share a feature from both human and animal. You can go from a human, from level 1 and another, or for an animal. So we have two ways to do that. And why creating furries? Well, because creating a furry, you have, you know, to create complex organ to graft on a human. We can also study how a pure non-human culture emerge from a pool of furry. Well, humans will gain something from furry because they have, well, friends with quite superpower, or they could have animal companions that will be more efficient, more autonomous, and more intelligent. What could furry do in the real world? The first thing, generally, furry tend to do is, well, furries will be used as super soldiers and things like that. For animal furries, they could be pets, or assistant, just like a guide dog, and well, there's a domain with the novelty of furries will be something that could be lucrative. So I will begin now with human versus furry, a kind that generally furries tend to think of because they want to be transformed into furry. So in this case, I will start with a consenting adult human, but will receive additional organs like a tail, a muzzle, etc., that will be grafted on his human body to create the appearance of his choice. So technology used will be mostly tissue engineering and 3D printing. The base of tissue engineering is the stem cells. There's a specialized kind of cells that are multi-purpose and are able to do many things quite interesting. First, they can multiply almost indefinitely, more than 50 times, and they can differentiate between several lines of specialized cells, like here, several organs. So you have a very universal toolbox in your hands. So to create an organ, you need to pile up layer after layer of stem cells in order to create various kinds of organs depending on the organization. You can regenerate an organ or a tissue by injecting stem cells, and the older cells will tell the stem cells what they have to do, and you can create almost any kind of organs on support sponges, like on the right, you have a collagen sponge viewed in a microscope. And then you can also create this kind of organ with bioprinting. The principle is to deposit stem cells and growth factor layer after layer with the shape that you want. In fact, this kind of system allows to create almost any kind of organ, even artificial ones, but not normal. And the technology is quite simple, but derived directly from existing inkjet printer. You can see that it's a slightly modified inkjet printer with cells in the normal color cartridge, and it's printing line after line rat kidney. So we have now all the bases to create the additional organs to graft in order to become a furry. The first part to overcome is to create fur. We know it's some humans can have fur from congenital or accidental circumstances. So it's possible to induce the growth of fur with a human from drugs or hormones. But for instance, the treatment with wabi have to be taken for life. And the length and color of the fur is not well controlled with this very crude system. We have to create ears. But I have to reassure you, we won't use this kind of technology. We don't need a mouse to grow hair. What we need is just to create a porous scaffold with the shape of the final ear we want, sprinkle it with skin stem cells obtained from the patient, and incubate all the thing with nutrients. And the stem cells will grow and make the ear. So it's simple. It's already done for some patients that have disfigurement. the shape is reliable. The only problem is that since we only made cartilage and skin with this method, the ears obtained won't be mobile. Then we have another challenge, it's creating a tail. It's much more complex, because a tail comports a lot of vertebra, cartilage, muscles, nerves. So we have two methods, we can either group separately the muscles, the vertebrae, etc. and assemble all that with microsurgery. That would be quite a pain in the ass. Or bioprint all that layer after layer. For bones, it's quite older, in the 90s it was already done with corals. For muscles, we can do that with gelatin tubes and a few anywhere to differentiate the cells into muscular cells. For nerves, it can be done also, it was found recently an axon regeneration enzyme. And for skin, we know how to make a scaffold and put differentiation factor in order to obtain correct multi-layer skin. For example, there you have an artificial skin obtained with stem cells. You have the epidermis and the dermis, so with all cells, and you can see that you have really two layers, two differentiated layers, but they are correctly binded. The skin is really strong. The next task is to create a muscle, and that, as you can see on this drawing by Kerr, it's a lot more complex. You have a lot more facial muscles, bones, etc. in a more complex configuration. So I think that it will be at least as complex as making two or three tails together in order complexity. And you have to graft it on the face of the patient. So a full face transplant is something that only a few teams, surgery teams in the world can do. No. So it's very difficult. After physical modification, we also have to do sensorial modification, because a furry is not only about appearance, it's also about sense. We cannot, with the existing hardware in human, obtain the same performance as a dog, for example, because we don't have enough cells, enough sensor surfaces to do that. But we can still have pretty impressive improvement through some three techniques possible: brain chip, drugs, and transcranial magnetic stimulation. The first one is the oldest. It was based on the work of a Spanish neurologist José Delgado in the 50s and 60s, who made work on birds, on dogs, on primates, and on humans, implanting electrodes deeply in the brain in order to stimulate one group of neurons. Where you see the control unit just under the skin, and then the electrode near the center of the brain. The kind of thing that conspiracy theorists think about every time. If we stimulate the oncus, we should have a tremendously enhanced sense, but also modification of the emotional stability, emotional sensibility of the people, of the patient. So it must be done with some care. The other possibility is to use drugs. It was the case of the famous neurologist Oliver Sacks. When he was a student, and eyed on a very unhealthy cocktail of drugs, and experienced this sense of love. In his testimony, he said notably that he could recognize people by smell, even if he wasn't able to see them. And it was really a unique signature that could be evocated easily. It was also possible for him to smell emotions, quite something that normally we can't experience. This enhancement lasted 3 weeks after the first cut of drugs, and it was really an enhancement, not a trade-off. He got a better sense of smell, but all his other senses stayed the same. So it was a loss for him after he finished. Then we have the last techniques, the transcranial magnetic stimulation. It's a method completely non-invasive, with nothing on the brain. You use only two coils, magnetic coils. A magnetic field will create a local electric field inside the brain, near a group of neurons that you want to stimulate. So this electric field will polarize the neurons and activate them. If you repeat the procedure long enough, the long-term activity of this neuron will be stimulated or inhibited depending on the procedure, and that the result will be permanent. A result that I have found a study about patients suffering from loss of sense of smell from Parkinson. And they use this technique to restore their sense of smell. Because that in 80% of the case, the enhancement lasted at least 5 years after the procedure with no needed to reduce. Making the same procedure on healthy subject could enhance their sense of smell in a durable way. So we are on the basis for a generic protocol about creating a new man as a furry. You have to prepare stem cells. You can use for that a strand of ears or another mucus. For the more adventurous, you could use blood or bone marrow. That would be easier. You extract adult cells, and then you transform these adult cells into stem cells with a recent protocol. So the patient won't have to do anything during this period and the next one when you create the organs needed for the transformation. So you mix the stem cells, the growth factor, the nutrients, you make all the organ growth by blood printing, etc. You control the quality and the functionality of the organs, make sure that the muscles are contracting, the nails are conducting electricity, etc. And then you have to take the patient in on the operation room to graft. First the tail and the ears, you stop there, you have a catgut or cardioid. Then you have to transfer the muzzle. You have to account about 24 hours of operation to do that. Something like that. So that's quite a feat. And then you can start the treatment to make the fur grow, to grow the fur of the modified human, and re-educate him for all the muzzle and tail in order to get working organs. So, we know that human furries could be quite attractive, not as much as human, but sufficiently that we can envision that they could have relations with unmodified humans. But there are something that these human furries are biologically still human, so they will have human children. It's something that could pose some issues because the child will have some problem to understand why he is human and what his mother is not. You have a very, very long procedure during which the patient will be half human, but not totally furry because of the transition, and it won't look good during this time. Also, you have to replace a large part of the everyday object to accommodate for the new body, and it will generally be custom made and quite expensive. And also that the facial expressivity of a furry will probably be low compared to a non-modified human, because it will be difficult to coordinate correctly the facial nerves, etc., to get a correct expression. You know, for furry from animal. Well, it's quite a different matter. We can start from the embryo, because there are not more problem of consent. And then we can use genetic engineering to obtain proto-human abilities on animals. It's chimerism. The principle is quite simple. You have two couples of different species. First species to second species. You create embryo for each one. And when you have embryo at the molecular phase, no more than 8 cells each, you fuse the embryo together to obtain one embryo that has cells from the two species. In fact, it's a technique mastered since the 80s with this example of a sheep goat, of a deer. You can see there from which animal the various tissues and organs gain. So we could do a human animal chimera. In fact, a British law in 2008 allowed several British labs to undergo research on human animal chimera and hybrids, at the condition that the embryo were destroyed after 14 days. So we are just one implantation away to obtain this chimera. The outcome will be unpredictable. It will look a human, a dog, in between. I don't know. So for genetic engineering, you need just a few things about DNA and genes. So I will give you some basis if you don't know that. So genes, the DNA, it's present in almost every nucleus of our cells. It's the support of a genetic code that shows to the cells how they have to build and maintain our organism. It's composed of base pairs that give us the genetic code, and organized in genes, that is that are the base unit to create protein and chromosomes. And then you can modify the genes either by natural or artificial mutation or direct manipulation. You probably have viewed in your textbooks in high school the classic model. Generally, we say that one gene will produce one protein that will act in one cell. The fact is that genes tend to act in a cascade. You will have top gene, that we will call OX gene, that will create regulation protein that will act on other genes, that will then produce protein that will act on other genes, etc., etc. In order that the OX gene will be able to control the development of whole parts of the organism. So, we have basis on genetic engineering. Now, to start. I will start, take the example of the domestic dogs as the base animal for modification because, we master its breeding, we know how to breed them. Their social structure is similar to humans, so we can integrate correctly into the furries, could integrate correctly into the human society. The dog are already quite intelligent creatures, able to infer the intention of their master and to know the objects of the everyday object by their name, more or less. And we already use them in specialized assistance. So the furries, animal furries, could do the same, but probably more efficiently. First, we have the singing dog, that is, he's singing. He's able to modulate his own language just like he was singing. So we know that his larynx is probably already abnormal, and we could obtain a speaking furry with this one. It's able to, extremely flexible, able notably to put his paws like this, and to crawl into space no bigger than his head. So for a search and rescue dog, it's going to be quite interesting. And then there are one of the few breeds of dog that are truly able of night vision because of a reflecting membrane behind their retina. The other possibility is the Sulimov breed that was created by the Russian airline company Aeroflot for its own purpose, but was to have an excellent sniffer dog that will have the sense of smell of a jackal and the heat and cold resistance of a husky. So that to have the best of both worlds, the best of both worlds. So we'll need, after my research, I found that we'll need at least four genes to obtain a furry. So the first one, the LAMC3, is a gene recently discovered that will control the folding of the cortex during the embryogenesis. Here you have a schematic of the dog brain. You can see all the circumvolution, and the wrinkling at the surface of the cortex. So if we replace the animal variant of this gene by the human variant, the cortex of the animal will be human-like. After that, we can use also the classic fox speaking gene, that is generally called the gene of language, because it controls the development of the several era in the cortex that control language, the Broca era, the vernacular, and also allow the development of lung and vocal cords. So we have what we need to make the singing dog really sing, in English if possible. Then we have also two answers to use. The first one, the HKDR-332, is a very specific human application. Normally, this section acts on a gene that tends to inhibit the production of neurons. But as you can see, the human biome is completely lacking. There are nothing there. So that means that this gene is not activated. And there are no limitations for the production of neurons. And that could explain why we have a bigger brain. So, we could obtain a dog with a big brain. Could be useful. And then, we have another very specific to humans genes that have the main characteristic to allow the growth of the tumor. As you can see there on the mouse, you can activate that and you create a tumor. So it could allow perhaps a furry to stand up because it will have human-like hips. But so we have our four genes. We need to place them into the genome in order to obtain the target. The problem is that we, if we place these genes at random, we probably make them not on another existing gene and will be erased or modified, and so we disturb the genome. But I found a technique made in 2004 that allowed to replace the genes at its emplacement in the genome, piece by piece. So we just need to know the promoters of the gene in the animal genome. The principle is you have to sensitize the promoters of the target genes, these two parts.
Yeah.
They are flanking the target genes. Then you recombine these promoters to the human variant of the gene. Yeah. So you have your composite. And then you recombine the whole thing in the animal genome. And you have replacement of one gene by another. But after that, we know where we need to place the genes. But we have to transfer the genes into the cells, into the germ cells, in order to obtain this furry. We have two methods possible. The first one, done by a South Korean team in 2009, is genetic cloning, transgenic cloning. The principle is if you transfer the gene into skin cells, and then use the skin cells in a cloning, in order to clone the individuals. The principle is quite simple. You use two dogs, one female and another. You extract one egg and the skin cells. You modify the genome of the skin cells and keep and extract the nucleus of the egg. Recombine the two in order to obtain an egg with the modified genome, and then you transit to obtain a puppy. So I have another possibility, that is sperm-mediated gene transfer. The principle there is to use specific chemicals to transfer a brand of DNA inside the nucleus of the sperm cell. So the advantage is that when you have modified the sperm cell, you can use it normally for insemination, and the fecundation will occur normally, naturally, so the success rate will be a lot higher than with cloning. So you just have to get your dog to give you sperm cells, modify it, and then you can use it in insemination. It's not simpler. So then, protocol, quite simple. The principle that you have to gather enough material of dogs, transfer the genes into the sperm cell, the oversight, depending on the technique you use, implant and obtain embryos and puppies. So quite a lot if necessary. You will obtain heterogeneous puppies without one copy of the human genes in their of the four human genes in their genome. And you have to do some selective breeding and redo the third step. So in order to inseminate the third generation with other sperm cells in order to obtain homogeneous puppies, we'll have two copies of a human genes in their genome. So the outcome will be extremely varied depending on the number of copies, depending on the homogeneous, heterogeneous. So for example, we could have between a simply intelligent dog able to understand its master, etc., to a humanoid dog with, able to stand up, to have really prehensible hands, able to speak, etc. But, I'm not sure what will be the outcome. At least you can make a small kennel, make some experiments, and see what will work. The first thing to know is that these furries won't be simply talking animals or small humans, small furry humans. They will be in between, something quite alien. The first thing is that we have a human-like cortex, but the rest of their brain will be still animal, still dog-like. They'll have probably a sand-basal mental universe, contrary to the side-basal universe we have as human. Also, the fact that if they are able to share feelings with their master and owners, to speak, etc., it's probable that we will be able to have a much stronger bonding with them. Also, dogs are already able to detect iniquity toward them by comparison to other dogs. So we can know that probably animal furry will develop their own set of ethics and morals, but probably not based on the same system that humans. Also, I got often this kind of question about uprising, spread, etc., end of the world. Always. I don't think that it's really possible for the moment. The first thing is that human equipment is not adapted to canon morphology, and that a humanoid or really humanoid animal furry won't have the same hand as a human, and probably won't be able to pull a trigger or think or stuff. The spread will be extremely limited because normally if you have a mixed couple with a normal dog and a humanized dog, the puppies will only be humanized if all the other human copy of the genes are all dominant. And then also, normally you will need a certain amount of people, a certain number of individuals to have a stable population, a viable population at short term and long term, a shrinking group. For dogs, you need at least 50 animals for short term, 500 for long term, and generally it will be only respected at the kennels. But not in the general population. You'll only need one or two humanized dogs with their owner inside a population of normal dogs. And the main problem is that we have to decide if these furries will be our partners or our slaves. The fact is, the marker of slavery are quite common, quite understandable, and it could be applied to human dogs. Because, in fact, a normal dog would probably look like a slave. So the problem is, if you have a corporation that create and sell these dogs for purpose that they are trained for, it will be ethically just or not to get sold for to serve one purpose. But the problem, the issue of consent, that could be quite problematic, because if a humanized dog can consent to a situation, that means that he can take the responsibility. But in the law, a dog is not responsible, is not supposed to do anything by himself. Also, for military or police dogs, they have a problem of to accept danger. The normal dogs tend to follow their master, follow the order of their master or owner out of loyalty and instinct, but that won't be possibly the case for humanized dogs. So for the moment, as a very stopgap system, I think that we need to use what we call it the outspets solution. In this case, we'll be able to give them a few rights that will make the thing a little better. So, now I have finished with animal bezephory, I will just give a very rough timeline that will be based on this very strong hypothesis that the funding needed for each kind of furry is already is constant, is already present. For a short term, we can do the chimera can be done right now. For a cat girl, it should not take that much because the ears are simple, the tail is more complex, but you don't need a lot of features to make it work. You can create quite easily the first generation, the first line of genetically modified dogs with human capabilities, even if they can speak for the moment. In my opinion, we'll need at least 15 years to obtain a crude, correct furry, human basal furry, because it's very, there's a lot of challenge to overcome. But if the first humanized dogs are successful, we could extend the procedure to other species, like the domestic fox, for example. And then for the long term, well, we'll see, because even I don't know how we could do that. So, to conclude, the base to obtain furries are already exist or in development, but we'll need a lot of research and developments in order to get them to work. Animal basal furry, in my opinion, will stay marginal for a long time, because we cannot master easily the final appearance and the ability, non-human abilities of these furries. Animal basal furry are, in my opinion, also much more promising and could be done in 5 to 10 years. But the problem is that they won't probably be easily accepted by a human society, mainly because all the science fiction literature now always spoke about hybrids in terms of uprising of subculture, of destruction of humanity, replacement of humanity, etc. And the population has to be educated into accepting furries. In the adults, you also have the bibliography about some work. Thank you.